Hi, I'm Dr. Baldeep Singh. I'm an internist here at Stanford, and today we're going to talk about the physical exam portion of a patient presenting with low back pain. Given that most low back pain originates from the lumbar vertebral area or the paraspinous muscle, we're going to be focusing primarily on the musculoskeletal portion of the exam today. But at the end, we will review some can't-miss diagnoses to round out the differential. So today, Steve is going to be joining us to help us demonstrate some key aspects of the physical exam. We're going to try to focus on four specific areas: inspection, palpation, some key provocative tests, and end with the neurological exam. Let's start with inspection. So Steve, if I can have you stand this way, first thing you want to notice is the contour of the spine, focusing on kyphosis, any kyphosis or lack of lumbar lordosis, as those can contribute to low back pain. Next, you'll have the patient bend over. Steve, if I can have you bend over, looking for any scoliosis, in which case you will notice that one side of the spine may be raised in comparison to the other side. Next, we'll move to the palpation portion. So try to focus on two areas, and we're going to palpate, either push or tap directly on the spine, looking for tenderness specifically, and then start to place some pressure on the paraspinous muscles to differentiate potentially a spinal cause of pain versus a paraspinal cause of pain. In this portion, we are going to review some key provocative portions of the exam, starting with the tripod sign. So while the patient is remaining seated, we're going to try to lift the affected side. In this case, let's say the patient is describing radicular pain down the right leg. So by elevating the right leg, if the patient has pain, note that both arms will extend, hence causing a positive tripod sign. Next, to confirm our finding with the tripod sign, we will proceed with the straight leg sign. Elevate the affected side to between 30 and 60 degrees. Beyond 60 degrees, it may be a false positive. As you elevate the leg, you should elicit pain if someone has some evidence of significant lumbar radiculopathy on the affected side. Then, to confirm that, you can also drop the foot by 15 degrees and dorsiflex the foot, confirming our positive straight leg sign. Next, we're going to be doing the femoral stretch test. The femoral stretch test is very helpful when considering a diagnosis of lumbar radiculopathy in the L2 to L4 region. The straight leg and tripod signs are very helpful in L5 and S1 radiculopathy, but if you suspect L2 to L4, which is much rarer, you would take the leg, bend the knee, grab the base of the knee, and extend the leg up. If the patient complains of pain on the anterior thigh in response to this maneuver, it is very suggestive of L2 to L4 radiculopathy. In patients with low back pain, typically conservative treatment is very commonly prescribed, as most patients improve with that. However, in some cases, if the patient has a concerning history for more serious radicular pain, you may want to proceed with a neurological exam, as this may result in further imaging or consultation. We are now going to be focusing on the neurological exam, focusing primarily on three key areas: the motor exam, the sensory exam, and the reflexes. Given that the vast majority of lumbar radiculopathy comes from three levels, L4, L5, and S1, we will be focusing most of our time on those areas. Starting with the motor exam, we're going to focus on three areas: L4, L5, and S1. To test L4, we're going to have the patient bend the knee and kick out, thereby tensioning up the quadriceps, checking for L4. You want to always compare to the opposite side. Go ahead, Steve, and kick, so you can compare both sides to make sure they're equal. Next, we're going to proceed to L5, in which case the patient will dorsiflex the foot and the big toes, comparing both sides, putting quite a bit of pressure in order to elicit any subtle difference between the two sides. Finally, we'll end with S1, where we have the patient plantar flex or push down as hard as possible on both hands, again comparing both sides to see if there's any S1 discrepancy. To confirm the findings on the neurological exam we just demonstrated, we'll now assess L5 and S1 in a different way. So what I'll do is I'll have Steve walk across the room, walking on his heels, looking at both toes to see if one foot is dropped. Go ahead, Steve. If there's an L5 weakness, we'll see that one foot will drop in relation to the other. Next, to assess for S1, we'll have Steve stand on both toes and walk across the room, looking at the heels to see if one heel is dropped in comparison to the other. If that is the case, it is suggestive of a significant weakness of S1. Next, we're going to be going to the sensory portion of the exam, focusing on L4, L5, and S1. To start with, we will try to take a monofilament or pin and try to distinguish if there's any numbness on one side as compared to the other. In the case of L4, we're going to be focusing on the anterior lateral aspect of the thigh, looking for any discrepancy in the dermatomes. Patient will say that one side is number than the other. Moving to L5, the space between the first and second toe. Again, looking for any discrepancy in the dermatome, patient will describe numbness. And finally, ending with S1, which is the lateral aspect of the foot. Next, we're going to be moving to the reflex portion of the exam, focusing again on L4, L5, and S1. For L4, we would bend the legs, patient's legs slightly while they're lying down, and while their leg is very relaxed, try to elicit a patellar tendon reflex. Next, for L5, put your fingers across the medial hamstring, trying to elicit the medial hamstring reflex, looking for the hamstring to activate above your hand. And finally, for S1, we would bend the leg, dorsiflex the foot, and again, with the patient relaxed, tap the Achilles, looking for a jerk in the Achilles tendon. If the neurological exam is normal, usually you don't need to proceed to advanced imaging such as MRI. We can usually start with simple treatments such as anti-inflammatories and physical therapy and see how the patient does. If the patient continues to do poorly, patient's symptoms persist, we can typically have the patient come back in 6 to 8 weeks to reassess and thereby decide if we need to do further testing later. Finally, while by far, in a way, issues with the vertebra or muscles are the major causes of low back pain, be sure to look for these can't-miss diagnoses. Malignancy, infections such as osteomyelitis or epidural abscess, where patients may present with signs and symptoms of infection, inflammatory arthritis, and lastly, or very rarely, other areas that can mimic low back pain such as prostatitis, pelvic inflammatory disease, kidney stones, an aortic aneurysm, or gastrointestinal disease. That concludes our video on the low back examination. I would like to thank Steve for helping us demonstrate key aspects of the low back exam today. For future videos, please visit the Stanford 25 website.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University. Please visit us at med.stanford.edu.